Adam alayhi salam was made into a physical clay, but he was dark. The light wasn't there. Life wasn't in him. And Iblis, the king of the shayateen, he had a high rank with the angels. He wasn't an angel, he was a jinn, but he had a high rank with the angels. He comes up to this big being and he started to kick it. He started to kick mold, which Allah molded. Allah says, فَإِذَا سَوَّيْتُهُ, when I have molded him, meaning he molded the shape of Adam alayhi salam with clay, with the earth clay. He left it there for 40 days, according to the narration. And Iblis came and kicked it and felt jealous of it. Iblis is made out of fire. Iblis has a high rank with the angels. Why has Allah created this being out of the lowest form of material? The angels are made of light, according to the hadith. The jinns are made of the heat waves. And the human being is made of clay. Allah is going to create him and give him a gift. Why? What's so special about this clay? So he comes and kicks it. It has a sound. He knows it's where hollow on the inside. Nothing special. And he used to say, for what amazing matter has Allah created you? For what amazing matter has Allah created you? It has to be something enormous. Something's going on here. Then Allah started to place the soul in Adam. Started with his head. So the most important part of your body is your head. He sneezed. The angel said to him, say Alhamdulillah. He said, praise and gratitude belongs to Allah. And so these became the first words that the human has ever uttered in his intimacy with Allah. Intimacy, relationship. The first words that of the relationship between us and Allah was the phrase, Alhamdulillah. Which means that if you want to nourish your soul, say Alhamdulillah and say words of dhikr. Allah's first words to Adam were, Yarhamuka Rabbuk. Your Lord gives you mercy. Not Yarhamuka Allah, Yarhamuka Rabbuk. There's a difference. Rabb means maintainer, provider, caretaker, the creator. You use it also for your parents, or you use it for anyone who's in charge of maintaining and protecting something. Allah is the maintainer, protector, provider, nurturer. So Allah uses the word Rabb. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to make you feel that you are under His care, Allah uses the word Rabb. And when He takes away something from you, it's in order to remind you that He is your Rabb. So when He takes it away from you, remember you don't own it. Who owns it? Allah. Who controls it? Allah. What does that mean? He's the Rabb. So Allah said, Yarhamuka Rabbuk, your Lord gives you mercy. And those were the first words from Allah to the human being. No one else received this gift. The first words from the human was Alhamdulillah. The first words from Allah to the human were, your Lord gives you mercy. Allah. What kind of a gift is this? First it's mercy, then it's this special soul, and there's this intimacy happening. Shaitan is getting jealous, he's about to crack his head, and then suddenly the soul reaches the stomach. Now he feels hungry. Adam wanted to get up and eat, but his legs, they were still paralyzed. There's no soul in them. So he couldn't get up. And Allah said, خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ مِنْ عَجَلٍ. Yes, man said Alhamdulillah. Yes, Allah, He gives him mercy. Allah is his Lord. But there's a problem. There are desires. When the soul reached the desire, Allah merely said, خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ مِنْ عَجَلٍ. Man was created out of hastiness. Now hastiness is the enemy of our intellect and the enemy of our soul, desires. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was patient with us. Then the soul reached the legs and Allah said, فَإِذَا سَوَّيْتُهُ, once I have molded him, listen carefully, وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي, and I have blown into him from my soul, فَقَعُوا لَهُ سَاجِدِينَ, then immediately bow down in prostration to him. Allah did not order the angels and Iblis to bow to him when he was a clay structure. He did not order him to bow to him when it was only in his head, where the soul was only in his stomach, but when he was fully inside of him and the gift was given, which was the soul. Allah said, that's when you have to bow to him. We are not favored because of our bodies or our beauty or about how good we look on the outside or our status in society or how much we can show ourselves in pride. We have been gifted with a common gift, which is called ar-ruh, which is the soul. And then Allah completed it with the guidance of Islam. Islam is in order to protect that soul, number one. Number two, your mind. Number three, your body. And all of it returns back to honoring the soul. All of it. Because Allah said, as soon as I place the soul into him, bow to him. So it's the soul that Allah gave us as a gift, and it's Islam which he gave us to maintain that soul. Then Allah said, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. And then Allah taught Adam all the names. فَقَالَ. And then he said to the angels, tell me these names, tell me these facts. And they said, we've only been given little of knowledge, Ya Allah. But realize, some people assume that the angels were called to bow to Adam when he was taught the names. Actually, they were told to bow to him when the soul was placed into him. Intellect rises and falls. But intellect was also a gift. And the intellect of the human being was something which he did not give to the angels. Therefore, the human being has been given two things, two tools which he gifted us with, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then gave us Islam to be guided with, the soul and the intellect. And Islam fits the soul and the intellect perfectly. Anyone who goes off Islam, your intellect is ruined and your soul is ruined. It doesn't work any other way. Iblis became jealous of this and he refused to bow, and we know the rest of the story. And then we were tested and so on and so forth. The first test was with Adam. A simple test. He said to him, don't eat from that tree. That tree doesn't even have a name. We don't even know which tree. Which tree? That tree. When you say to something that, we don't even know which one. Which one? Well, it doesn't really matter which one, because it's not important, because that's not the purpose. We'll show you what the purpose is. The purpose is to live the gift of Islam, submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you trust in Allah, because you know Allah knows more than anyone, because you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your creator and he's your Rabb, and he'll only guide you to that which is the best. When do we refuse the gift? When do we start tarnishing the gift? When do we start abusing the gift? When we start abusing our submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Disobedience. That's when the gift starts to become boring. Becomes boring, the gift of Islam. And that's when we complain. We say, why is Islam not giving me happiness? Why am I not guided? Why do I still feel miserable? The problem's not in the gift, yet. The problem is that you abuse the gift. You need to fix it. You need to fix the gift again. You need to fix Islam. The Sahabas in the past, the Tabi'een, they used to say that we treated Islam like the crown on our head. And the world, everything else, was like material in our hands. When the crown went out of place, we dropped what was in our hands and fixed our crown. Today, it's the opposite. The crown on our head is the world, materialism. And the deen is in our hands. When the crown, which is the materialism, goes out of place, we drop Islam and fix our material, and then we complain. Adam ate from the tree and he was destined to be on earth, not because Allah was angry with him, not because there was something special about the tree, but it's that connection, the gift. Allah wants us to keep that relationship with him. When Iblis was able to play with his head, he abused the gift which Allah gave him. And Allah wants him to be stronger than the shaitan. He wants to be stronger than the desires. It starts with a footstep, and then the next, and the next, and the next. And Allah wants to teach us that our curiosity is what makes us lose the gift. Because everything forbidden is desired. You say to yourself, the only reason it's forbidden is because there has to be something good in there that I'm missing out on. For example, if I got five boxes, and I place five boxes here, five boxes. And on the first four boxes, there are no locks. No locks. And I revealed to you what's inside of them and then closed them. On the fifth box, I had a lock and I said, nobody is to open this box. And if you trust me, there's nothing special in there anyway that will benefit you. So don't worry about it. Then I placed the key next to the fifth box and I walked out. What would your minds tell you to do after a while? To open the box that has the lock. So my dear brothers and sisters, our curiosity is a killer. We have to take what we're not allowed to take. So you open this box and what do you find in there? Nothing. Then you go, damn, I opened the box, I feel guilty, and I didn't even get anything out of it anyway. Now imagine you opened the box and there was powder, gunpowder in there and it exploded. And you harmed your fingers. You're going to regret for the rest of your life. Why? You shouldn't have done it. It was forbidden. There was curiosity. Isn't it correct? So first thing, Ikhwan, brothers and sisters, if you complain that Islam is not giving you the joy, it's because you violated something of it. Find out what it is and fix it, because it's impossible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you a gift that will harm you. And the first thing you need to monitor is this, that the only reason he forbids something is because it will harm you. There is no secret